Good morning, students. Today we are discussing the role of employees in corporate governance. Employees and corporate governance. Employees are the workers employed by the firm, and these employees have a direct stake in the company since they earn a livelihood from the company. As well as they get other benefits, both monetary and non-monetary, from the company. And these employees include both management and subordinate staff. And they directly influence the profits of the firm since they are involved in the day-to-day operations. The major goals of employees include adequate return for their services, job satisfaction, remuneration, job security, motivation and self-actualization. These are the basic motivators of an employee. And the employees are interested in the company's survival and growth because their jobs depend on it. And employees and other stakeholders play an important role in contributing to the long-term success and performance of the company. While governments establish the overall institutional and legal framework for corporate governance. So the interest or objectives or the goals of the employees must be protected. There are several strategies for protecting the interest of employees. Firstly, protection through other laws, encourage shareholder power, support of trade unions, employees' voice within corporation, changes in corporate culture and norms. Firstly, protection through other laws. The companies must try to protect the interest of employees through other areas of the law, such as general contract law, agency law, and especially employment law. This kind of laws gives employee or individual employees a certain set of rights. If a company violates one of these rights, employee may be able to sue in the court to protect their rights or seek remedies from an administrative agency. So the protection through the laws is one of the strategy for protecting the interest of employees. And secondly, encourage shareholder power. The employees share common interest with shareholders than managers. It may be noted that both groups will be affected with the dealing of managers. Shareholder interest may be brought closer to the interest of employees, since most of the leading institutional shareholder activists are union of the employees. So, encourage shareholder power is also another strategy for protecting the interest of employees. Then, there is another strategy, that is support of trade unions. The trade unions will have a large voice or they have a greater power to control and manage the employees. The trade unions have been in decline for decades and have become quite a small part of the private sector in many countries. But millions of employees still belong to trade unions, and labor law reform and a revised unionization strategy could increase the rate of unionization. So using the trade unions to increase the employees' voice over a variety of decisions is an important strategy with the corporates. Next is employees' voice within the corporation. There are many ways to give employees more voice within corporation. At the highest level, employees could elect some directors. This is an example for employees' voice in the higher level. For example, Germany provides work council at the plant level that give employees a voice on a variety of issues. That is, employees could have non-binding votes on particular issues, or employees' opinion on some matters could be surveyed. And lastly, changes in corporate culture and norms. The corporate culture should promote employee engagement. This strategy does not require any sort of legal change, but it seeks to promote change the company through affecting the norms of managerial behavior. That is, a corporate culture in which employees feel engaged offers many benefits to a corporation. So these are the strategies for protecting the interest of employees. And the interest of employees can be protected through various ways, such as trade union, co-determination, profit sharing and equity sharing. So trade union is one of the best way to protect the interest of employees. Trade unions can also refer to as employee representative, and they are basically a group that represents employees to the board of directors. They share the same objectives with the organization and maintain professional and ethical value when carrying out their organization strategy. And they have the responsibility of maintaining and controlling the employees, where a mutual relationship is formed between the employer and the union by creating an efficient industrial relationship. Thereby, they help to reinforce the productivity of human resources within an organization. And next is co-determination. In corporate governance, co-determination or co-partnership or worker participation, it is the practice of workers of an enterprise having the right to vote for representatives on the board of directors in a company. That is, it also refers to staff having binding rights in work councils on issues in their workplace. The concept of co-determination was introduced in Germany in 1951, establishing employee participation at two levels of corporate governance, that is, the firm level with work councils, at the plant level through the work councils, and at higher level with the employee representatives on the supervisory board. Co-determination is a democratic decision-making process at the firm level and the equality of capital and work. It brought about labor peace, reduced the level of unemployment, and added to the high growth of the economy. And the effect of co-determinations are threefold. That is, the cooperation and the utility of workforce can be increased when workers have a say in the organization. And the reduction of the number and intensity of conflicts in the workplace can be reduced through co-determination. And the greater correspondence between workers' powers and responsibilities, co-determination being the counterpart of workers' exposure to the enterprise risk. That is, the very fact is that the workers, unlike capitalists, cannot diversify between different enterprises when selling their services, exposes them to an employment and income risk, which induces them to make a claim to control. So, once again, through co-determination, the utility of workforce can be increased, and the conflicts in the workplace can be reduced through co-determination. It acts as a greater correspondence between workers' powers and responsibility. So, co-determination being the counterpart of the workers' exposure to the enterprise risk. That is, it minimizes the employee's enterprise risk. And next is profit sharing. Workers feel involved in the management of the organization, especially when they are given a share in profits of the business. So, it's a good plan. A profit sharing is a good plan that gives employees a share in the profits of the company. And through this plan, an employee receives a percentage of the company's profit based on its earnings. This is a great way for business to give its employees a sense of ownership in the company. It's a proper method of providing a sense of giving ownership in the ownership in the company. If an organization implementing the profit sharing schemes within their organization, it can promote workers' efficiency, it may raise the productivity of workers, and it make workers feel that their interests are identical with those of the employer. It increases the morale of the employees. That means they will behave in a more responsible manner, and it generates a cooperative spirit among the employees. To develop a proprietary attitude among the employees, it minimizes labor turnover, and it boosts industrial democracy. Okay, these are the benefits of profit sharing. Then last one, equity sharing. Equity sharing is another name for shared ownership or co-ownership. It's another way of profit sharing. That is, it's an approach to sharing equity with employees. That is to grant the employees some stock or equity in the business, or give them a chance to purchase stock from the company. Okay, giving the employees a chance to purchase the shares of the company, or the equity shares of the company, in a discounted rate. That is equity sharing. Normally, we know sweat equity shares are issued by a company to its employees at a discounted rate. It's an example for equity sharing. So these are the roles and the goals of employees in the corporate governance.